Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Triangle. It's wonderful to see you all this morning. For those of you who've been away on holiday, it's lovely to have you back. Or if you've been doing other things for the past few weeks, it's great to see you. And for anybody who's visiting us for the first time or feel that they've not been coming very long, it's really good to see you too. I hope you feel at home and that you belong and are welcome within our church family. We gather together to worship God, to praise Him for all that He is and for all that He's done. And as we do so, we're going to sing our opening hymn, which is 503 if you're using the hymn book, but the words are on the screen. 503, great hymn to begin our worship of God, love divine, all loves excelling.
Start our worship this morning. A hymn 200 years old and says exactly what it's all about. For us, today, yesterday, today, and indeed forever. No matter what modern hymns come along, that will always be the one. So now we come to our prayers. And first of all, a prayer of approach. Talking to God, I suppose, but indeed, all our prayers are talking to God. Let us pray. Good morning, Father. We're here again. It's Sunday, and we know you are here too. And that's great. Even though that's the case, we want to make it clear that we don't want you to think we're taking you for granted. No, we're not. It would be quite wrong to leave the approaching just up to you. So we approach you, grateful that you are approachable. That we can just chat to you and know you won't take offence at what we say or expect a lot of bowing and scraping. The best thing is, Lord, that though you're present already, you actually meet us more than halfway. How good is that? But we are not forgetting that you are mighty and great and wonderful and in many ways beyond our limited human thinking. With that in mind, help us to comprehend, follow and praise, because that's the right thing to do. And so we pray. Great God, our Creator, Redeemer and Sustainer, our parent, brother and friend, open our minds, open our hearts and our lives to your wonderful presence. Now in this time of worship, but also and especially in our daily lives, in our homes, our communities, in our workplaces, in the world, which is your village. Teach us again what it is to be your people, to know your glory, the wonder of your power, and the joy of your love, which is for all, whoever we are. And most of all, despite this, to know you are the approachable God and the caring Father who makes each of us feel we are the most loved of your children. Amen. And for forgiveness. Lord, we try to say all the right things and we want desperately to mean them. Sorry, Lord, when we don't do either. We know we let you and ourselves down. We know it happens frequently. It's easy to say, why bother, why should I care? Is it up to me? Let's admit it, we do that frequently. Sorry, God, please let us off again. But in future, give us what it takes to avoid doing wrong things and to make sure we do the right ones. Lord, the best bit is that we know you will forgive us if we really mean it. So we ask you now for that forgiveness. Help us to really mean it. Amen. And a short prayer of thanks. Thanks for all that goodness and care, and for all the good things you provided for us to enjoy. We cannot begin to count the many gifts we have from you. The material things that we have in this country and that we so often take for granted. The joy of our faith and the wonder of your love. We are grateful. We say thanks, but just make us aware that we need to recognise them more often. Amen. And now, Lord, we want to pray to you using the wonderful prayer that you gave us. We're going to pray in what we call our traditional way. And for all of us who need them, the words are on the screen. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And we continue our worship as we sing hymn 614, God loves you and I love you.
Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. But now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices, and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its Creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in the word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. May the Lord bless that portion of his word.
Amen.
Amen. May we continue our worship, called by Christ and by the disciples, for those, called by Christ to be disciples, for those using hymn books, number 660. Amen.
To preach on from this morning. Sexual immorality and filthy language. I think I drew the short straw when we did Bible morning. But I don't want to start with that. I want to start with another verse. I've told you this so that you may be filled with joy. Yes, my joy will overflow. And you may think, we didn't hear Bob say those words in that reading, and actually he didn't, because Jesus said those words in John's Gospel. He's talking about vines and branches, and he talks about my joy being complete in you, so that it will overflow. It's a wonderful statement, but more than that, it's a promise. In a world where circumstances can knock us about, we need a feeling of joy to get us through some days, if not all days. Because, let's face it, life is not a bed of roses or a box of chocolates. In real life, we have financial worries. We have relationship difficulties. We have physical challenges. We have sometimes a mountain of obstacles to climb over that no one else has a clue that are going on in our lives. And being a Christian does not automatically make things easier. In fact, being a Christian often complicates our lives. Being Christ-like in a non-Christian or a secular culture sometimes only adds to the tension that we face. So I suspect most, if not all of us, are in desperate need of the joy that Christ promised. We may never have experienced that overflowing joy that Jesus is talking about. In fact, sometimes I think we'd be quite happy if it wasn't overflowing, if it was simply just trickling through our lives. We know that soul-fulfilling joy is possible because Jesus promised it. He said that it would be. But how does that happen? Because we'd really like that to be a reality in our lives. Well, I bring good news, and I bring even better news. The good news is that we do not struggle with this on our own. If you're thinking, I'm the only person that ever thought and felt like this, can I assure you aren't? And that leads us to even better news. Because first century Christians needed to experience Christ's joy in their lives. Especially when, at this point that Paul was writing, they were starting to face really extreme persecution that just got worse and worse. And Paul frequently wrote about joy in his letters, and Colossians is no exception. Paul writes about a life-fulfilling joy that comes from knowing and understanding Christ, appreciating our relationship with him, and allowing him to change our lives. In our passage this morning, Paul has moved from quite deep theological debates and thoughts, and he's moving, as Paul always does, into practical things, like finding, for us today, purpose and enjoyment in being a Christian. Do you find that faith produces or provides purpose in your life? Paul is saying that the Christian life only works if Christ is at the very centre of it. We don't just believe in Christ and then let God do the rest. Sanctification, that process of becoming more Christ-like, requires us to be proactive, to actually do something. And this is when Paul gets really practical. He gets to the ethical demands his letters always make. changes in our lives that can mean our lives can be filled with joy. And he uses the illustration of changing your clothes to help the Colossians and ourselves understand. In Colossae, when somebody was being baptized, and it was in the very early days of the church, so this would have been a very common thing for them, they would go to be baptized. And to do that, they would take off most of their clothes, not all of them, but most of their clothes, and they would be fully immersed in water or a river. And when they went down into the water in their old clothes, and when they came up out of the water, the first thing that happened to them when they stood on the bank or on the side was that they were given a new set of clothes, usually a white robe, to represent the purity of Jesus and to show them that they were new creatures in Christ. So he's linking that illustration that they would have been very familiar with, very different to us just giving a child or an adult a sprinkling of water, and making it more understandable for his readers. He's saying you have to take off your old attitudes and the old ways of thinking. You have to strip off those practices and the things that you did, things that you did before you were a Christian, when actually you could live how you wanted to, but now you've got to take those things off, you've got to strip out of them, and this is a new suit of clothing that you're going to wear, so that in your life you bring honour to God and you grow more Christ-like every single day. Our old nature died when we accepted Christ into our lives. We've been raised to new life. We are new creatures, completely new, reborn, Jesus said in the Gospel of John. And therefore, the old ways of living, our old mindsets have to change. These are the things, in a sense, that are all about me. The thoughts that we have that are basically selfish and centre on us. Private desires, that Greek word is pleonexia. It is about an insatiable desire to have more, a ruthless self-seeking for all that we want. We leave behind selfish thoughts where we have been the centre of our own universe, where the whole of life has revolved around us. And Paul encourages us to change our wardrobe, to take off those things that have made us selfish, remove the hostile thoughts that we hold towards other people, of bitterness or the grudges we hold, the anger that we can feel, things that remain unforgiven. And Paul is saying, take them off as you would a jumper or a blouse or some other item of clothing. Take them off and have done with them. Angry and hurtful words, lies and fake news that we can spread, malicious and abusive speech, the things that tear communities and families and churches and nations apart, take them off and get rid of them, Paul says, just like you would at the end of the day when you take off your clothes. Well, we've taken off our old clothes. Those things that Bob read for us, the sexual immorality, the filthy talk, the different things that affect us. So we've taken off our old clothing and we're encouraged to put on something new. I really like that because one of my favourite pastimes is going shopping for new clothes. So has Paul given me permission to go shopping? No, he isn't. He again using that analogy of clothing, but he's talking about attitudes. He's talking about qualities of our heart. Interestingly, when I'm asked to do weddings, the passage that I am most asked to read is 1 Corinthians 13, the Love is Patient chapter. Occasionally, I'm asked to read from Colossians, and the next words that Bob read for us, the words that Paul speaks. And they are, in a sense, even more fitting than 1 Corinthians 13 for a wedding. But they are more fitting for us in our relationships with our partners, with our families, with our friends, with our work colleagues. These are the words that Paul offers to us instead. The things that we're to put on. A new way of thinking. A heart of pity and mercy. A heart that is moved when it sees somebody struggling or in trouble and reaches out to them. a gentleness that is about a balance in life, a patience reflecting the patience of God that bears all things and sometimes just has to let them go. Our speech, where what we think about, where we always question ourselves, is what I'm going to say now true, necessary or kind? And if it's not, just don't say it. A speech that is pure and true. A speech that is forgiving. When we are people of forgiveness, that knows that we've been forgiven by God, but offers that to other people. And to all these, Paul adds the bond of love, the binding power which holds them all together. And he encourages us to let the peace of God be the umpire in your heart. Like a referee at a football match, God makes the final decision, but he never gets the decision wrong. No wonder I am asked to read this passage at weddings sometimes, but it is meant for all of our relationships. It sounds wonderful and ideal, doesn't it? But I want to say to Paul, do you know, you're just not living in the real world. Because actually this is so hard to do. Get into any real life situation when we are tempted in some way, or a situation where we've been mistreated, or a church meeting where there's the potential of blood on the carpet, never at the triangle. And it brings out the worst in us. And that is when the words of Paul are really put to the test, when life is just throwing all the rubbish that it can at us. Does Paul really expect us to do this change all by ourselves, by our own initiative or by our own power? Well, no, he doesn't, because he knows that it's nigh on impossible for us to change the habits of a lifetime through our own endeavour and our own power. Because even though our old nature is dead, we know that old habits die hard, and we can very easily give them CPR and bring them back to life when things are tough. Let's face it, we are not good at changing ourselves, are we? We are not do-it-yourselfers who depend on a positive mental attitude that we are encouraged to have so much in the secular world that we live in. Left to our own devices, we are naturally powerless. But that is where God gives us the supernatural power, the Holy Spirit. Paul says in Romans, I do what I don't want to do, and what I want to do, I can't do it. That rings true for me, it may very well for you. I cannot change myself, and you cannot change yourself. And that is where we need the Holy Spirit. It's a not-so-secret solution to the struggles we have in our thinking, in our attitude, in letting go of the old us. It's to let the Holy Spirit take full control and full power in our lives. And that is what happens when we focus on Christ and not in the baggage of our former lives. This change is a continual renewal each and every day of our lives. We grow in grace, we grow in knowledge, and we grow more Christ-like day by day. One of the problems that we have in our society today is that we don't like people telling us what to do. We really dislike being told how to live by other people or that we need to change. Those in society who have been telling us for years that we need to cut down on drinking or cut down on eating or take more exercise have discovered that when you say to people, you shouldn't or don't do this, that we tend to ignore it. Yeah. But if you frame it in a different way, you know, if you took more exercise, you'd have a whole lot more energy to do lots and lots of different things. Our attitudes change. So when Paul says, we want to say, don't you tell us what to do. And you might very well be thinking, who are you to stand up at the front and to tell us to do this when you don't do it yourself? And that's very true. Suppose there are two towns. Suppose the first town behaves in those early verses that Bob read for us, wearing the old clothes. And suppose down the road there's another town that lives with the new clothes, wearing the things that Bob talked about later. Which town would you prefer to live in? There might be some who say that they would like to live in the first town, free to do whatever they want. They can live as they want, they can treat people how they want, they're having a good time, life seems really good. They might lose a few friends from time to time, there might be a bit dysfunction going on occasionally, but that's okay. They're doing their own thing and they're free to make their own choices. In town two, things might look very boring, made up of a bunch of wimps who are always saying sorry and trying to think about how they can help other people in life. How boring does that sound? And probably that might be a reaction that many people in life have around today. But isn't that a bit of a shallow response? If people lived wearing the old clothes, then the result is that families and communities and friendships get broken. And those things can lead to a breakdown in relationships very quickly that may never ever be mended. People may say that they're having a good time, but in quiet moments of reflection, they may admit to being lost or lonely or confused or bitter. And nor are the people who live in the second town weak-willed wimps. Have you ever seriously tried to forgive someone who has wronged you? Have you ever seriously tried to offer compassion and patience to somebody that actually you just don't want to show those things to? Being tender-hearted does not mean being sentimental. Being kind does not mean being a soft touch. Humility isn't the same as low self-esteem. Meekness is not weakness. But it's that thing that you get when a powerful horse has been tamed. It's still the same power, but now it's under control. Being loving doesn't mean letting people do what they want to you. Paul isn't saying you should do this because I'm telling you to. He's saying this is the way of Christ that leads to peace and leads to joy. And in living this way, you become a reflection of Christ himself. Have you ever tried to let God's peace, God's word, Christ's name be the reality around which you order your life? If you have, you will know it's not easy. It takes serious prayer and real commitment to live this way, a commitment that needs to be renewed every single day. What sort of actions and words will make a difference in your life, in your family, in your workplace, in our church? Think about them. Being tender-hearted, kind, humble, meek and loving. How could a situation that you're facing at the moment change if those attitudes ruled your heart? How might a relationship change if we changed our attitude or we changed the things that we said or the things that we did towards that other people? The Christian life is all about relationships. At heart, the relationship that we have with Christ, who died for us and lives for us, and that relationship we have with other people. In typical fashion, in the final week of Bible Month next week, Paul gets down to some real solid illustrations of what he's saying. Some of them that we will agree with and some of them that we won't. Some that were context of Paul's time and some that we can put in context today. So please pray for me as I preach next week about submitting to my husband. Or not. In our passage this morning, Paul ends with these wonderful words. Whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of Jesus Christ. If we do that, that joy that we were talking about, it will be a flow because Christ promises that to us. May God bless you. Amen.
Amen.
We come to our prayers. And just a moment of quiet as we start. In our prayers this morning, I want you to think about a pebble dropping into a pond, creating circles that spread out. And as we do, our first prayers are for ourselves and the situations we face. Not because we are the centre of our universe, but we find that when things are difficult and tough for us, it's hard to pray for other people. So we pray for ourselves, the situations that we face. And then the circle grows wider, and we pray for our family and friends, the people we laugh with and cry with. Pray for our church family as the circle grows wider. For those who are facing real difficult struggles at the moment, whatever they may be. But we remember with joy and we celebrate the things that some people are celebrating too. As the circle widens, we pray for people in our local communities, for our neighbours. We pray for those within our own country. We pray for the people of Whaley Bridge, and for the emergency services working so hard there. Think of the things that we've seen on the news within our country this week. Whether we agree with them or not, we pray for our politicians and those who have authority to make decisions about our lives. We pray for the world in which you place us. We think of those who were killed yesterday in a shooting in Texas, and for those who have lost their lives today in Ohio. We pray for the people of Hong Kong. The people of Palestine and Israel. Lord, we know that to get rid of our old habits and our old selves is incredibly hard, if not impossible. But nothing is impossible with you. So we pray for your Holy Spirit upon us, so that in everything we do this week, wherever we go, whoever we meet, we may show those wonderful characteristics that Paul talked about, that we may put on love and humility and kindness and patience. And we do it hand in hand with you, dear Lord, for we pray in your name. Amen.
Amen.
In a moment we're going to sing our next hymn, but before we do that, I've got an award to give. Joyce was nominated for a community service award. What she's done to deserve community service. I thought only bad people, naughty people got community service. But Joyce was nominated for a community service award. It was done in conjunction with Bolton Hospice. And she got the award because Joyce is a hero. But Joyce will be the first person to say that it isn't just about her. And this was for work in the coffee lounge and for the work in the church. And this isn't just for Joyce. She accepts it on behalf of everybody for all the things that go on here. Not just in the coffee lounge, but in all the other areas of church life. For you all do a wonderful, wonderful thing. I like to say you're good for nothing. Because you are wonderful. But I'll not ask you to come to the front, Joyce, but I will come and bring it to you. And congratulations, well deserved. Let's pray. Father, we thank you not just for Joyce winning this award, but we thank you for everybody here who offers so much of their time and their energy and their love to make the lives of other people better. We pray that you'll pour out your spirit upon us as a church, that we will go out and not be afraid to share our love and to share all that you've given us. Thank you that we are a family. Help our family to grow, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing our next hymn, 581. If you're using the hymn books, Come By Table is a meeting place as the children come back into church for us to share communion together. Into church. This is just to say that everybody is welcome at this table, whether this is your first time at the Triangle or whether you've been many occasions. It is for everyone to come to this table. The wine is non-alcoholic, and if you can't have bread, then just let myself or Brian know. There will be a station here, Brian among the stewards. And I'll be stationed here myself and also one of the stewards. I invite you, Joe and Doreen, our community stewards, will invite you to come forward and just come to either one side or the other, whichever is free. But you're welcome to come. If you cannot come to the front but would like to receive communion, just let the ladies know and then we will come to you afterwards. But everybody is accepted at this table. The words will be on the screen. This is the table, not of the church, but of the Lord. It is to be made ready for those who love him and who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little, you who have been here often and you who have not been for a long time, you who have tried to follow and you who have failed. Come. Not because it is I who invite you, it is the Lord. It is his will that those who want him should meet him here and find the peace that only he can give. Not an easy peace, not an insignificant peace, not a half-hearted peace, but the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ is with us now. So I invite you to say good morning, to share the peace, to just say hello with those around you. And especially those perhaps you do not know. Let us hear the story of how this sacrament began.
On the night on which Jesus was betrayed, he sat at supper with his disciples. While they were eating, he took a piece of bread, said a blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body. It is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Later, he took a cup of wine, saying, "This cup is God's new covenant, sealed with my blood. Drink of it, all of you, to remember me."
So now, following Jesus' example and command, we take this bread and this wine, the ordinary things of this world, which Christ will make special. And as he said a prayer before sharing, let us do so too. Gratitude, praise, hearts lifted high, voices full and joyful. These you deserve. For when we were nothing, you made us something. When we had no name and no faith and no future, you called us to be your people. When we lost our way or turned away, you did not abandon us. When we came back to you, your arms opened wide in welcome. You prepared a table for us, offering not just bread, not just wine, but your very self, so that we may be filled, forgiven, healed, blessed, and made new again. You are worthy of all our praise. So now, in gratitude, we join our voices to those of the church on earth and in heaven, throughout the world and across the ages.
Holy, 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 holy God,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And now, lest we believe that our praise alone fulfills your purpose, we fall silent and remember him who came because words weren't enough. For us you were born. For us you healed, preached, taught and showed the way to heaven. For us you were crucified, and for us after death you rose again. Lord Jesus Christ, present with us now, for all that you have done and for all that you have promised, what have we to offer? Our hands are empty. Our hearts are sometimes full of wrong things. We're not fit to gather up the crumbs from under your table, but with you is mercy and the power to change us. So as we do in this place, what you did in an upstairs room, send down your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us your body, healing, forgiving and making us whole, and that we may become for you your body, loving and caring in the world until your kingdom comes.
Amen. Amen.
Among friends gathered round a table, Jesus took bread, broke it and said, "This is my body, it is given for you." And later he took the cup of wine and said, "This is the new relationship with God made possible because of my death. Take this, all of you, to remember me." Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us your peace. We invite the stewards to come forward. We just have a moment of quiet and silence before we share in our closing prayer for communion. We say together, Lord Jesus Christ, You have put your life into our hands. Now we put our lives into yours. Take us, renew and remake us. What we have been is past. What we shall be through you still awaits us. Lead us on. Take us with you.
Amen.
I hope that you're able to stay for tea and coffee and conversation after the service this morning. It would be good to chat together. I always think it's nice to go out of church with a smile on our face. So we're going to use a YouTube clip. We're going to invite the children to come to the front because they know the actions. And hopefully we've got a smile on our face as we worship God. So we're going to invite the children to the front to do the actions. The sun coming. We're going to do the actions together. If you don't know them, you'll soon pick them up. But we're going to stand together and we're going to sing My Lighthouse.
Sure.
Let's come next week and do it all again. Let's do it all week. Shall we share the grace together? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.